Hi, here we are on Friday the 16th, and I want to talk about something that a lot of people might have missed that happened this week, a big event in my estimation. The Argentinian stock market and the Argentinian peso crashed, like in one day on Monday, 38% for the stock market, the peso down 29%. Now they've come back, you know, a little and all, but this happened for a very simple reason. There's a new government, some referendum or something that showed that a new challenging government may win the election in October, and this is going to be a protectionist party. Surprise, surprise. I hate this. I was just talking with Andy Pancholi and got to see him in London not too far ago, my co-author on Zero Hour, and he was talking about, we really nailed this political revolution and this Trump and Brexit thing. This is going to happen around the world. Protectionist governments, you know, the end of globalization for now and stuff. And this is just another sign. This is about the market seeing this new government that could be the type of government, you know, Argentina first, default on foreign debts, you know, and then that causes defaults and corporate debts and all types of things. And so this is the most likely trigger, the biggest debt increase after the debt bubble into 2007-08, which was mostly developed countries and mostly in the financial sectors, leveraging up on financial institutions and then derivatives and all this stuff to insure that stuff. That was the big thing then. It was developed countries having a debt bubble. When we started flooding the world with cheap dollars and euros and stuff to bail our countries and major corporations and financial institutions, it made it easier for emerging countries to borrow. So they went on the last borrowing spree. Now, U.S. and West and developed country governments have increased their government debt substantially, but most other sectors, you know, corporate and household and stuff are more flat to down. We've been deleveraging a little bit, and financial institutions deleveraged more. But you know, most of the debt, other than that, has come in the emerging world, and most of that's been in corporate bonds. Guess who's the champion of this? China, 163% of corporate debt, way more than government, household, financial, anything else. That's where their bubble is driven. The Chinese government implicitly guarantees this debt and allows local crony projects to be funded by contractors supported by local communist parties, and that's how they're building stuff for nobody and growing their economy. That's how they stimulate. They print condos, we print money, you know, in developed countries. So this is just a sign. You know, obviously we've seen big problems in Turkey, Venezuela's already a basket case with hyperinflation, not something most countries will see, and certainly not what we're gonna see, but that does happen, especially in banana republic type of countries and stuff. So this is the most fragile debt in the world. We have way too much debt still, way too much derivatives, all this stuff. We need a trigger. Last time it was subprime mortgages. This time I think the most likely thing to start defaulting is emerging governments, but more so emerging corporate debt, and China's got the most of it, like they've got of everything else. And they may not be the first to go, but when they go, see, that's my point. You know, something happens in the United States, or housing slows down, or we're not spending enough. Okay, flood the economy with more money and da-da-da-da-da, wealth effect, and at least we get some impact. We can't impact the implosion of wealth in China if they're debt starts to collapse and get and cause problems, and people start to say, oh my God, and real estate starts to fall, and oh my gosh, we own a bunch of empty real estate, we better sell. There's nothing we can do to stop that implosion, or not much, with our printing in our countries, because they've already borrowed from our printing and stuff, and it'd be too late at that point. So that's something I am going to talk about in the upcoming September issue of Boom and Bust, for people who are on that. So look for that. And the other thing, real quick, for everybody on economy and markets, I gave an update in the markets on Tuesday, and show we're at a critical point. I've been telling the Boom and Bust subscribers this for a good while now. Critical point at 1525 on gold. That's an important resistance point. And of course, stocks have been coming at three tops at slightly higher highs and important resistance points there. And we're testing them. And all of a sudden, on Tuesday, gold went down right from that point, and stocks started to break up again after correcting, and it looked like a reversal. Well, then the next day it reversed more. So we're still at this critical point. I gave some, you know, targets for how stocks could go and gold and stuff. We haven't broken quite low enough, just a little bit below my support on stocks before they could go up. And we've broken back off, especially this morning. Friday stocks are supposed to open up and gold down. We'll see what happens the rest of the day. I'm recording this in the morning, but we're still, you know, going back and forth. Is gold going to break up or down, or stocks going to break down or up? Because they're going opposite each other over these issues. And we're at a critical point, and we'll keep you updated. Still not clear and still at a critical point. So we'll be talking to you more ahead.